I don't believe Jesus rose from the grave, declares atheist minister Bernie Deller. I am persuaded that Christ the Lord is risen today. Indeed, proclaims Christian counselor Rick Livingston. Our topic today, did Jesus really rise from the dead? Welcome to heaven, where according to the Bible, resurrected believers will dwell forever and ever, and to the council here show. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is the pivotal point upon which Christianity stands or falls, according to Bible teacher and author Steve Gregg. I'm Rick Livingston, host and a biblical counselor for 24 years in private practice in Hillsboro, Oregon. The guests in a few moments, humanist minister and atheist Bernie Deller, who will be debating me, and chartered financial consultant Robert Baker, who will be moderating the debate between Bernie and me. So we have Bernie with us, who is, well, I'll introduce him in a moment, but Bernie, welcome to the show. Bernie, can you hear me?
Yes, can you hear me now?
Oh, shoo. I was about to have a panic attack. I can hear you just fine. Unfortunately,
okay.
Our moderator's not on the line here yet, so I hope he gets on in the next minute or two, because I want to introduce him. But meanwhile, Bernie, who likes to prove me wrong, claims to be a former born-again evangelical Christian, now a secular humanist and a polytheist, leaving belief in God just 3 years ago. Bernie has a bachelor's degree from Oregon Institute of Technology in electrical engineering, a master's degree from Luther Rice University in ministry, and works full-time as a computer chip designer. Bernie organizes discussion group meetings on science and religion. He moderates and presents at many local religious debates and discussions. And Bernie is a minister of the Humanist Society under the umbrella of the American Humanist Association, whose slogan is good without a God. I'd like to introduce Robert, who's our moderator. He's not here yet, so I will give some introductory info on him. And if he hasn't arrived, we'll take a quick station break and then be back, and hopefully I'll be able to get a hold of him. I did talk to him a little bit ago. So anyway, Robert is a chartered financial consultant who works in the financial services industry with a Fortune 500 company. In other words, he's a financial wizard. He's been in the financial services industry for 14 years and in business management positions for 17 years. Robert has a BS in economics, and he is one of my best friends. And I haven't noticed him getting on, so we're going to have to take a station break while I get a hold of him and see if there's a problem. Hopefully everything will be okay. So we'll be back in just a moment, and then we'll be starting our debate. Well, we got a chance for some classical music here, and we're back on the Council Here show and ready to begin our debate. Robert, you're with us now, it looks like. Welcome to the show.
I'm here.
Good. Good to have you on. We did a little introduction just to summarize it without going over it again. Basically, you're our resident financial wizard who will be moderating the show. Is that pretty cool?
Glad to do it.
Okay. And at this point, I'm ready to turn over the reins to my good friend Robert, and he will begin by reading the ground rules. Go ahead, Robert.
All right, the ground rules. There are two halves to the debate, first starting with Bernie's printed statement that I will read, and then Bernie will make his opening statement. In the second half, we will do the same except starting with Rick. After the opening statements, there will be some rebuttals between the debaters. Then we will take phone calls for questions from listeners and comments from the debaters. When there are no phone calls, we will return to the rebuttals between the debaters. Debaters should stay within their time frames. I will give a 15-second warning for each debater to wrap up his last sentence. After the call-in and or exchanges, each debater is allowed a short summation. A short break divides the first and second halves of the debate. So to start then, I will go ahead and read Bernie's printed statement. Why I don't believe Jesus rose from the grave. There's a very important saying for people who value critical thinking. Extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. Not only do Christians claim that Jesus rose from the grave, but there's a whole lot of baggage that is bundled with that claim. That Jesus is now alive and ruling from heaven, sitting at the right hand of God, and that Jesus is God and existed prior to his birth on earth. Not only is the doctrine, then you could believe any competing religious claims that are made in a similar vein, such as Muhammad splitting the moon into two and then rejoining it, Quran 54:1-30, which would have many witnesses. The story of Jesus rising from the grave is simply Christian mythology, comparable to Mormon mythology, Muslim mythology, Hindu mythology, Greek mythology, etc. And thus, formerly Truman Smith, now known as Bernie Deller, opens with a flourish of unbelief. And Bernie, it's time for your five-minute opening statement.
Okay. Okay, first off, one thing, can you hear me okay, by the way?
Yes.
You're fine.
Okay, one thing, I listened to a debate with William Lane Craig, for example, and one thing he says, and he also refers to Plantica, who's another Christian apologist. They say, you know, with all this evidence, it's just that the best evidence for the existence of God and all that is the feelings that you have. You have a personal relationship with Jesus. And then the evidence is just kind of like icing on the cake or something to show other people. But you know yourself because of your relationship. So I just want to start off by saying I know I've had that relationship. I am a former born-again evangelical Christian. I know what it's like to feel like you have a relationship with Jesus. I even talked to Mormons, and they said to pray about the Book of Mormon, and God will give you a burning in the bosom if it's true. And I actually got that burning in the bosom. But I was saved from Mormonism because of my brain, so I did not become a Mormon. And in the same way, you can be saved also by thinking. Feelings cannot tell you any kind of truth. They can't tell you 2 + 2 = 4 or 5. It can't tell you if Jesus rose from the dead or not. It can't tell you if Mormonism is true or not. Feelings are not a valid form of epistemology. That's a way of knowing. And that's a key point to underline and repeat, that feelings are not a valid form of epistemology. That's my first point. My second point is extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. If I said I have a car, you can believe that. But if I said I had a spaceship that could, capable of intergalactic travel, then you should doubt me, because that hasn't even been invented yet as far as we know. And if I said, furthermore, give me all your money and we'll go zoom away tonight so you don't die in an asteroid collision tomorrow, then I'm asking things of your life, and now you really need evidence. And so in the same way, the Christian, when he wants you to believe the resurrection, he's asking a lot of things out of your life, so you should really ask for more evidence. Another thing I want to say, this is the third point, that this is a historical claim about whether Jesus rose from the grave or not. Now, a lot of Christians don't know this, but the Gospels are anonymous. Nobody knows who wrote them. Even though they're called Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the academics will tell you that truly nobody really knows who wrote them. And the oldest and most reliable manuscript is Mark, and even in Mark, it shows that there was added verses to it. For example, the original text ends with them not seeing Jesus rose from the dead, and then there's some verses added. In the NIV, they have footnotes to tell you that the earliest manuscripts don't have that text. Fourth of all, I want to tell you there's nothing to resurrect. You know, there's this old idea that we have a soul, but we really don't have a soul. All we have is the mind that emerges from the brain. Therefore, it doesn't make sense to even believe that you're going to be resurrected. This would really help to learn about neurology, because then you learn about things such as how the brain operates. It operates in parallel, and our mind puts together images into one monolithic idea, but there's not one person inside of you that figures everything out. That's an old idea called the homunculus. Another problem is that when you look at a historical claim, miracles are the least probable. I mean, for example, there's mental magicians like Darren Brown. You can swear he's doing magic. I mean, his magic is real. If he claimed to be God, you might believe it because it's just no way to explain what he's doing. So, you know, how much more something that is so removed, all these old ancient stories. And the last point I want to make, because Rick referred to this as prophecy, and I want to say, first of all, nobody, as far as prophecy, nobody at the time of Jesus thought that the Messiah would be crucified. So that was a total shocker. Christ. The New Testament is all over that. Now, Jesus is going to return very soon. I could quote you some passages, especially in Revelation. These things are soon to come. So those are my 6 points. How much time do I have left?
About a minute.
Okay, so I just want to summarize. I have 6 points. The first point is that no matter what people say, they say that they know that this is true because they have a feeling. I'm going to say I have those feelings, and feelings cannot determine truth. Number two, extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. Number three, this is a historical claim, so you should treat it as a historical claim. Four, there's nothing to resurrect because there's no such thing as a soul. There's only the mind, which emerges from the brain. And you can number five, you can't go back and analyze miracles just like the magicians have today. We don't know if they're real or not because we can't see them and test them. And six, failed prophecies all over the Bible. So I'll leave it there.
And that's time. Very good. Rick, rebuttal for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Robert. I appreciate you being here to help us with this debate and this exercise. And Bernie, I appreciate you being here too. And I've enjoyed our acquaintanceship over the last couple of years and times on the show. Okay, so you started out by saying that the best evidence that some Christians, I guess, and you quoted somebody, was feelings. I don't know if feelings is all of what Christians are about. Some of the greatest minds in the world in history have been Christians, like Nicholas Copernicus, Saint Francis, Sir Francis Bacon, John Milton, Rene Descartes, Isaac Newton, T.S. Eliot, C.S. Lewis, many fabulous minds, Faraday. I guess the point I'm making there is that I don't think these people were just feeler people. I think they also had intelligence and minds. I know that many of the institutions of education, MIT, Harvard, some of the other institutions started with Christian influence, and you also have hospitals that begin with that influence, many of the hospitals with some kind of Christian compassionate outreach. So there's a lot of our culture and civilization that's based on people that are just not feelers. But speaking of feelings, I don't think feelings is a bad idea. I know that there's a sun, and I know I have a hand. Now, I could read a book about it and get an education, go to school, but, you know, frankly, the biggest proof is I see it come up every day and go down every evening. So I know that there's a sun. Well, actually, now and then here in Oregon, we miss it. Oh, well. Robert is further east of us. He probably has more faith in the sun than we Oregonians do. But my hand, it's there every day, and so I see that. Babies, how do they learn? Babies are the geniuses of the world. They progress at such a tremendous rate of intelligence, far beyond ours, and yet a lot of it is their feelings. Feelings are a big educational part of us. And so, yes, if we feel or if we experience a born-again experience in Christ, then that's it. So feelings should not just rule, though. And I agree with Bernie to that point. Feelings should not be the whole sum of our understanding. Feelings are, I like to say, great servants, terrible masters. Bernie claims to be a former evangelical Christian. He had the feelings, he says. I believe he did have some feelings, and unfortunately, that's all they were. Bernie was not a Christian. I can say that. Now, that might sound almost arrogant to say that, but the only way that I could say that he wasn't a Christian or that he was a Christian is that he's not truly an atheist now. Because how can you believe something doesn't exist if you say that you once were friends with that one? Because the definition of a Christian is one who knows God, who knows Christ. Jesus himself said that in John 17:3. So that's bogus. I hope he becomes one. I hope he has the true experience that goes beyond feeling and into reality. Historical gospels. No one knows who wrote them. That's not true. I don't have time in this 5 minutes to get into that in detail, but they're well identified by people, and scholars throughout the ages have recognized that. Yes, there are liberal scholars today, particularly the Jesus Seminar, that delight in refuting anything and everything of that nature, but that doesn't make them right or counter historical and even present conservative thought. Manuscripts in addition to Mark, I'm not going to have time to refute all of what Bernie had to say, but I'll get a little bit of this, but the manuscript additions in Mark, yes, it's true. There are a few extra things that are in Mark, actually in John also, John beginning of chapter 8, Mark the end of chapter 16 at the end, but this has to do with different manuscripts. All I can say is that the overwhelming manuscript consistency of the Bible so supersedes the very few copies that we have of Herodotus, Thucydides, and some of the other historians of the Greek and also of the Roman tradition back then, and no one seems to be questioning them. We don't have a soul. All I can say is that that's sad. I do feel sad for Bernie to be cut off from that very essence of who he is, because there is something we all recognize. There's something within us that speaks to us, and it's more than just a machine that we're operating.
Okay. I would like to encourage anyone listening to call in with their questions, and they would call area code 760-283-5126, and Rick will actually receive those phone calls and manage those.
Let's get that phone number again.
Yep, the telephone number again is area code 760-283-5126. Okay, now we're going to have a 3-minute rebuttal. Bernie, you first.
Okay, can you hear me all right?
Yes, go right ahead.
Okay, yeah, I'm sorry I cannot have a regular discussion with Rick, because I would really like to have a give and take with him to let him know that feelings are not an epistemology. That is not a way of knowing. There is no way to determine truth by feelings. This is a very serious point. In critical thinking, there's things called logical fallacies. And to think you could determine truth of a thing by feelings is called the appeal to emotion. I mean, it's so easy. I mean, he should be able to agree that when a Mormon says, oh, pray to God for a feeling about the Book of Mormon, and that will validate the truth of it, you know that's, you don't accept that, because you know that's nonsense. Your feelings can lead you astray. So it's ridiculous for people to claim that feelings can determine truth, and yet this is what William Lane Craig has said, and Plantinga has also, he refers to Plantinga. So this is a common Christian fallacy. Yes, I was truly a Christian at one time. I did feel a relationship. I did feel led by God. Everything that Rick does, he just doesn't understand what a delusion is. I now see it as a delusion. There's really nothing inconsistent there. He doesn't understand that he is deluded. And the way you know about, the way you can overpower a delusion is by wisdom. For example, when you see a mirage in the desert, you can be sure that it's a mirage because of your wisdom. So even though your eyes show you something, you know it's not real. And also, the Gospels are, this is another important point, the Gospels really are anonymous. This is what the PhDs from the best seminaries all agree on, as far as I understand it. I mean, this is something that Mark Berman also pounds home. Of course, conservative scholars will disagree with that. That's like saying Mormon scholars will disagree with you about the Book of Mormon. Of course, the Mormon scholars are going to say the Book of Mormon is perfect, you know. So you don't just talk to the people who promote it. You talk to the academics who have the best experience. And the best academics in the Christian world who are Bible scholars will admit that the Gospels are anonymous. And also, he makes a point about all these other documents that are ancient. How come, you know, the Bible has better evidence for it? Why don't we question those other documents? Well, because those other documents don't demand things of your life. And if they do, such as the Hindu scriptures, you don't seem to care about that. You don't seem to look into that. So the reason why this is important to look at is because it's so that the demands are so high that they place on you, that Jesus rose, you know, from the dead, and he demands these things of your life. You need to change your life if you accept this message. You just don't go on like nothing happened. So that's why it's so incredibly important. How much time do I have left?
You're just about out. 10 seconds.
Okay. Just one thing to mention. I was introduced as a polyatheist. That's kind of tongue-in-cheek. That just means that there's a lot of, just like a polytheist believes in many gods, there's many gods I don't believe in, so I'm a polyatheist.
Okay. Rick, time for a three-minute rebuttal.
Okay. I'll try to get in some poly ideas here. Bernie wants to talk about feelings here, so I guess, you know, I'll get into that. I'm a marriage counselor, marriage and family counselor, personal counseling, but I do a lot of marriage counseling, and I'm pretty focused on the area of love. I think love is important. And while love can't be proved any more than God can be proved, it's sad if a person denies that love, since love is a feeling, doesn't exist. I think that there's more to it than just feeling. So a person perceives the love of his spouse, if he's married, based on some of his feelings. And there are emotional components to that. We do pick up on things. In fact, our soul is involved in that. But feelings are also in the physical realm. We have five senses, and we can perceive things from that, too. By the way, if a person smiles, the different things that they do, so we pick up things from perceptions also. And then also, there's other evidences. For one thing, other people's opinions, and we can pick up things from that. We can see that something exists because there's confirmation from other people. There's accountability there, and that also helps confirm what we believe is true love. That's why friends, parents, family help present something that can bring about a better picture of love. Also, the things we observe in a person's life, their faithfulness and reliability, things that we appreciate about them, that they're very supportive of us and they stick with us, and the fellowship that we have with that person. In Christian language, with God, it would be the koinonia that we experience. So, I think there's a lot that comes into play. Is feelings involved? Yes, but it's a lot more than feelings. Now, Bernie said that I'm deluded. thanks. I'm glad you recognize that. I believe that on Judgment Day, we'll all be delivered from some of the heresies and the false ideas that we had. And I'm going to appreciate that washing. I hope I get as much washed out in this life as possible. Maybe Bernie will help me with some of that. It does sound a little bit religious in a way, because the idea of samskara in the Hindu tradition is that there's not really sin, it's all delusion. There's just the big illusion, and that's the illusion of desire, and the Buddhists go with that also. So I'm not sure what to make out of that. It's easy to say, I guess I could say, Bernie, you're deluded, but I'm not going to say that. I'll let him figure that out. So there are fine minds that come from some of the seminaries that don't agree with what Bernie's saying. Some of the greatest minds of the 20th century, like Karl Barth and C.S. Lewis, would see it differently.
Thanks, gentlemen. We've got about 30 minutes until the break, and I want to remind listeners that they can and hopefully will call in. It's area code 760-283-5126. Please call in with your questions or comments. That telephone number again is area code 760-283-5126. And now, gentlemen, we will go into rebuttal. And based on probably how many calls we get, if we don't have many calls, I think I might stretch the time out from 1 minute to maybe 2 minute rebuttal. So, Bernie, you are up.
How much time is it? 1 minute or 2 minutes?
Let's go with 2 minutes for right now. Unless we get some calls, I might shorten
it.
I mean,
just going back to the saying, I said that feelings are not a method of epistemology. Epistemology means a way of gaining knowledge. And Rick responded back, well, hey, I feel love. I feel sorry for if you can't feel love. Love has nothing to do with determining truth. You can't determine if an equation, a mathematical equation, is correct by feelings. You can't determine if the Book of Mormon is the Word of God by feelings. And in the same way, you can't tell if Jesus rose from the grave by feelings. You just can't. It's not a way of knowing. It's a very simple point. And to believe that you can is a logical fallacy called appeal to emotion. And there may be other fallacies involved with it too, but it should be obvious that you cannot determine truth. And, you know, like I said, this is actually something that, you know, Rick said this is one of the witnesses that he has, among other things. And I'm just saying that is not a way of knowing anything. And then just as far as being deluded, I was once deluded, yeah. I mean, just like I said, it's like seeing a mirage out there. I realized I was deluded, and I believe that you are deluded. That's not name-calling. If we're in a desert and you're very thirsty and you see a mirage and I say, hey, you're deluded, that's not name-calling. I'm just trying to tell you there's a situation there that you're seeing things that don't exist. And that's what I'm saying. When a Christian believes in God, they're seeing and feeling things that don't exist. It's a delusion. So it's not name-calling. It's just, you know, trying to state the way what's going on there.
Rick, 2 minutes.
Yeah. I'm going to give my 2 minutes, and then we have somebody on the line. So that way we each get our 2 minutes, and then here we go. So Bernie said love has nothing to do with truth. I just wonder then if being married is a delusion also, because if love has nothing to do with truth, then really why would one get married if there's no love? Because if there's love is not a function of truth, or if the love isn't truthful, or so that something to that degree. Anyway, somehow this seems to be incomprehensible. To me, the highest values we have to do with both love and with truth. So I guess that goes past me. Maybe we can pick that up after the phone call. I want to make two more footnotes. One, I'm going to bring some very concrete type of evidence when it's my turn, when I state my positions. So we're not going to just go by what he's calling feeling. I wrote a poem a while ago, and here's a little stanza out of it. Before I met you, I was not alive. The sun would rise, the sun would set, my eyes saw nothing but the empty azure shell of my existence, nature's clever lie. The planet spun nowhere, who needed hell? This is the state of someone who has not been resurrected, in other words, born again. And Christians are all raised from the dead. In order to be a Christian, Bernie would have had to have been resurrected, because if he wasn't raised from the dead spiritually, truly spiritually, not a feeling, but the spirit, which goes beyond feeling, then I'm not sure what he experienced. I feel sad for him.
1 second.
Okay, I don't need the rest. So anyway, I want to get to the phone call here because we have someone on the line, so I'm going to bring them on, and then he can address either Bernie or me, and then we'll both make comments, and Robert, you can referee us. Okay, so we have someone else on the line, and can you give us your first name and what state you're calling from?
The name is Herb, calling from Oregon.
Okay, Herb, go ahead. You can ask either one of us or both of us a question. And Robert,
well,
it's yours now.
I'm a Christian, but I really don't go much at all on the idea of feelings as being a source of reliable belief. So I would disagree with the Christian speaker to some extent on that. I think it is very important that the historicity of the events of Jesus' resurrection are recognized, because it's not something that I feel he's risen, but rather that he historically was rose. And in that regard, I would ask Bernie, if he's the name is, how do you deal with the evidence of all of these disciples and witnesses making that statement and being willing and almost to a man and woman dying, willing to die for it, with no one ever recanting it? It would seem that would be a strong evidence of the conviction that they had that this city really did historically rise. That's all.
Thank
I
you.
Would like to
thank clarify. You, Herb. Yeah. Okay, Bernie, you want to respond?
Yeah, as far as witnesses dying for their testimony, this is something that Robert Price has mentioned, and I think Bart Ehrman also, that they said basically there is really no good testimony on that. It's just hearsay and gossip, basically. It's you know, probably secondhand. It's just they're not reliable sources for that. And also, as far as the witnesses, you know, the earliest gospel is Mark, and that was written something like, I believe it was 30 or 40 years after this event of the resurrection, which is claimed. And then the other synoptic gospels basically collaborated with that, basically took it and modified it and worked with it. So basically they're all kind of similarities. Some of them are amped up. One reason why they believe this is because Mark kind of has a matter of fact, a lot of statements on a lot of things, and the other ones amp up the story. And you can also see some of the discrepancies. And so here's the oldest gospel, which is the most accurate, doesn't even have an account of Jesus being seen, by the end of it. It's just the body's gone. And there's some man who appears to Mary and talks to Mary and it doesn't say it's an angel or anything. It just says a man and says Jesus is not here. And then you see a footnote in the NIV that says, hey, the following verses aren't in the oldest manuscripts, which is the more accurate manuscripts. So right there it shows you there's added stuff in the Bible that's not part of the original. So you can ask yourself, why is there added stuff in the Bible when they know this stuff is not in the original? I mean, it's obvious this is not in the original text, but they can't take it out because then there'd be a big scandal. They'd say, like, hey, why are these verses missing from the Bible? So...
All right, Rick.
I'll leave it there. Was I talking too long?
No, you did fine. Rick, 2 minutes.
Okay.
I forgot the name. What was your name again?
Herb.
Caller from Herb. Okay, Herb.
Herb.
Yeah, I've been so busy writing notes that I can forget easily. I would agree with you that by themselves, feelings are not reliable, and I don't believe in the resurrection of the dead because of Jesus Christ, because I felt it. In that sense, that's not the basis of my belief. So your line of questioning, I think, is good. And I will be getting to that when I present my position, which will be in about, I don't know, well, whenever this half is over, I'll be presenting my evidence. I'm responding to what Bernie's saying, and he claims to think that that's what we have is feelings. But I don't think feelings are completely unreliable. It's just it works in tandem with intellect, with external evidence and a number of things. The death of the disciples has been accepted throughout Christian history by great minds like Augustine and other great minds throughout Christian history, and has been reported that way. And so I think that there's a pretty good case for it. In fact, one of the disciples we know of right in the gospel or in the book of Acts, the brother of the Apostle John, James, was martyred very early on, and it's recorded somewhere around Acts chapter 11 or 12, somewhere in that neighborhood. So I think we have some evidence there. As far as Mark, it wasn't written 40 years afterwards. It was probably written somewhere between 25 to 30 years afterwards. But Mark was a close friend of Peter, and there's quite a bit of – are we about done with my time?
Yeah, 15 seconds.
Okay. Well, I have more, but maybe I'll get it in later. We'll see what happens. Did you want to address anything with Herb or with Bernie, or where do you want to go with this?
Herb, did you have another question?
Well, I would like to follow up that discussion. about the witnesses. The beginning of the book of the Gospel of Luke is very clear. The word that's used there for the people that he wanted to interview were the people who had, in that culture, would memorize things word for word, and they were starting to die. And that's why he felt it necessary to record what their witness was. So I think you have a very clear example in the beginning of the book of Luke that the witnesses were there, that they were interviewed, and that they were no longer going to simply rely on an oral tradition. They had to put this down into writing. So I think the witnesses were alive when Luke wrote, and he recorded what they said. That's all.
Thank you, Herb.
Okay. I have a comment on that. I think there's a matter of what they call intellectual honesty here, and the church kind of corrupted this, I think, with people. You know, just the very words saying the Gospel of Luke is not intellectually honest because it's anonymous, and nobody knows who even wrote that. And what Bart Ehrman says is that these stories were passed on verbally by person by person by person to person, like a game of telephone, for the purposes of converting each other. And at some point, it was written down by some guy who's pretty good with Greek. The original disciples would have spoken Aramaic, and they're probably illiterate. There's even a passage that says, you know, these men, I think it was Peter and John, Peter and somebody, that they were unlearned, you know, they were unlearned and uneducated people. So they're probably illiterate. That there was a lot of verbal copying back and forth, and it finally got down, put down in the words, but who wrote that? I think it's dishonest to actually say that's the Gospel of Luke because nobody knows who wrote it.
Rick, rebuttal?
There's a lot to say, but Luke was very specific. It wasn't just the title of the book, the book of Luke, but it says, where is it? Inasmuch as many, I'm just pulling this up here. Maybe it's in the book of Acts. I'm getting a little lost, but the caller, Herb, is very accurate. He goes to great pains to identify who he is, that he is a doctor. He's mentioned also in the book of Acts recorded by Paul. And you have these tedious lists that Luke comes up with. He's not only a doctor, he's a good historian. It's considered the most historic book in terms of attempting to be historical accurate as opposed to Matthew, that is more of a teaching book. It's more organized that way. Not that it's not as historically accurate, but Luke takes great pains with history. Both of those books have tedious long lists of inspired boredom, that is, lists of history and one person after another being named, and the reason why is to promote the historicity of that. So I think that, you know, to say that it's not accurate, I don't understand that. Then in the beginning of 1 John, John himself, who was his closest disciple, said, "That which was from the beginning, which we have heard," I guess that's a feeling he had, he heard, that's a physical feeling, "which we have seen with our eyes," that's another feeling, a physical feeling, "which we have looked upon and our hands have handled," there's another feeling, "concerning the word of life." They experienced, I guess the question I would ask of my listeners is this, when we really zero in on the resurrection, when I start beginning the arguments for that, are you going to believe John, who heard, saw with his eyes, along with many others with him, and even touched with the hands and leaned his head on the bosom of Jesus at the Last Supper, concerning the word of life? Are we going to believe that, or are we going to believe some seminarians that have a particular agenda, and also Bernie's position?
Time's up, Rick. Okay, so I wonder if we want to entertain another question from Herb. Rick, that might be your call, or if you guys want to go into more rebuttal to each other. We've got about 16 minutes left in this half.
We don't have another caller. If Herb has something else to add, otherwise I've got more to rebut.
I'll stop.
Let's tie in another caller
because we might get more callers after that.
Thanks, Herb, for joining us. All right, Bernie, it's your time for a couple minutes.
Well, I already talked on this one. I thought you said we have another caller. I talked first, right?
Yes. So, Rick, do we have another caller?
Not yet, and I'm here to respond to Bernie during the first half here. So, if he doesn't have anything to say, there's more response I have to some of the things he said. I'll leave it up to him.
Bernie, it's your turn.
You've got two minutes.
If we go 1 minute, then we will be going back and forth, but we'll be doing it in an equal paradigm. So that's the idea of the 1 minute. So
okay, let's go to 1 minute, Bernie. You got 1 minute.
Okay. On one debate I saw with Robert Price, he wrote The Incredible Shrinking Man, I believe. He also did a Bible Geek. He's a liberal guy on the Jesus Seminar. But anyway, he's saying, like William Lane Craig, when he gives his, you know, he says, oh, all these New Testament scholars believe so-and-so or whatever. You know, he's just talking about these are the conservatives. There's a huge difference between people that are biased and people that have, like, academic PhDs. I mean, for example, there's seminaries like Yale and I think Harvard. Some of these schools, they have really high standards. You know, you have to learn a couple different languages and all that. And then there's all these little theological schools. You know, for example, Dallas Theological Seminary, Robert Price said, you know, over there they learn so much about Greek and Hebrew and all this stuff, but what's all this training for? I mean, they can't even come up with something new because they'll get shot down as a heretic. They have to fit right there in their tight little theological circles. So anyway, my point is like, what are these academics are saying? The church is really kind of ignorant of things they teach in church. For example, they'll teach in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. John wrote this. But the academics say John was written around the year 90 or so.
Mark is
by far the earliest manuscript and the best. I mean.
Okay, Rick. You've got a minute, Rick.
Well, I had a pastor that once said that seminaries sometimes can be cemeteries for people who have faith. I wouldn't make a blanket statement that way, but in some cases, and Bernie referred to the Jesus Seminar, they are probably the most radical anti-Christian group in the world. They have some PhDs there. It is possible to be an educated fool. I have a master's degree. That doesn't make me smart. Living the life in the faith of Christ, I prefer wisdom over knowledge. Knowledge can sometimes very much, as the wise man said, puff up, but love builds up. Okay. Bernie can have my 15 seconds.
Okay, Bernie.
Well, yeah, I mean, Rick, if let's say, for example, you argue with a Mormon and some Mormon says, you know what, this is what the Mormon scholars say about the Book of Mormon. You're going to say, like, do you think I care about what the Mormon scholars are saying about the Book of Mormon? Seriously? Do you care what the Mormon scholars are saying about the Book of Mormon, Rick?
I'm taking it you want me to respond to that.
Yeah.
I would care if there was any truth to it. I've studied some Mormonism. I want to take them seriously because they are significant, you know, as a movement. They're a large movement that started in our country close to 200 years ago. And so I read some of their materials. I read criticism of those materials. And when I weighed it, I found a lot of it was rather wanting, you know, so I do have some ideas that they have contradicted the scriptures, and they hold the Book of Mormon to be superior to the scripture, and I have a problem with that. And also so many inconsistencies.
Okay, Bernie?
See, my only point is to evaluate the Bible like you would the Book of Mormon. Don't give it a special privilege just because you're born into it or because you're in America.
Okay, I do want to address that. I will admit that I have had prejudice, but my prejudice was not the way you might think. I grew up in the 1950s and then into the 60s in a synagogue. to us, the equation of a Christian was sometimes we thought was like a Nazi. We thought that the Christians in Europe supported the Pope, would not oppose what was happening there. So we were familiar with the anti-Semitism. We were familiar with prejudiced Christians that would say that we were Christ killers. So when I approached Christianity, there was a lot of that. And then also living in California and visiting the Bay Area, there were some pretty radical Jesus freaks that tried to shove things down my throat. So I saw formal religion through some of the more formal realms where I saw hypocrisy, and I saw fanaticism. So I did not approach Christianity. It was only when I saw a group of people that were really living the faith that my mind and my heart opened up.
Bernie?
Okay, let me I think there's some obvious myths in the Bible. For example, I think Carl Sagan said this to somebody. He says, you know, in Acts, it talks about Jesus ascended up into heaven. You know, he physically rose up and went beyond the clouds. He goes, did you know that if he's traveling at the speed of light, he still hasn't escaped the Milky Way galaxy yet? You know, the Milky Way galaxy is 100,000 light years in diameter. That means it takes 100,000 light years at the speed of light to go across the entire Milky Way galaxy. And the Milky Way galaxy is one of hundreds of billions of galaxies. So it's like, where is Jesus going? But if you see this through the ancient and ignorant eyes, they thought, hey, you know, heaven's up in the sky. So when Jesus ascends, he's going to physically go up there. So this is an example of, you know, obvious myth in the Bible. They got caught writing according to their ideas. And there's a lot of other myths, too, like, you know, if you get bit by a snake, you won't die. And these dead people came out of the graves when Jesus died on the cross.
Okay, time's up.
I mean,
Rick?
Okay, Bernie, there's a modern term, so I won't be ancient and ignorant here. It's called ethnocentrism. And I think what you just said kind of has that flavor in it, and you might take a look at that. When you say ancient and ignorant, it's kind of like those ancients are ignorant. There's a concept that all knowledge and today we're really where it's happening, and that's ethnocentrism. It's basically pride and arrogance, and we have to be careful about that. I've noticed that that is common with many intellectuals. Also, you asked a good question. Where is Jesus? Where was Jesus going? That is the question. That is a good one. And it's not ancient and ignorant for us to ask basic questions like where did we come from, which science has never been able to answer that because that's not in the realm of science. Science has a great place, but that's not one of them. That's metaphysics, not physics, and that's the realm of philosophy and theology, and that gets into
Bernie?
The soul and the spirit.
Bernie?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, the ancients were ignorant compared to us. I mean, they thought things like they had this geocentric view, like the entire universe revolved around the Earth. And then, you know, we got the heliocentric where we thought, okay, well, everything goes around the sun. And then we realized, oh, wow, the sun is just one star of billions in the galaxy, and there's billions, hundreds of billions of galaxies. You know, they believed in a flat Earth. They didn't know anything about DNA. Of course they were ignorant. I mean, that's obvious they were ignorant. And they wrote according to that ignorance, and now we can bust them. We can say, aha, you have a made-up story because you thought heaven was up in the sky, and now we know it's not there because we have spaceships that have gone up there. We have a rover on Mars. There is no heaven up there.
Rick.
So I'll leave that there for you.
Well, I'm glad that we're not in an ignorant day. We're in a day where we know that abortion is a good thing. We're in a day where we recognize that marriage has been poorly defined through several millennia. We're in a day where we're no longer ignorant of the fact that God doesn't exist. I don't think today necessarily things are better. I don't think that our society is better than it was even 40, 50 years ago, where when I was growing up, I didn't even know what marijuana or meth or heroin or any of those things were until I was about 18. And I grew up in a big city high school. But today, well, anyway, we've gone from chewing gum to shooting guns in the schools. So just because progress moves us forward doesn't mean it really does. Sometimes it's a backward thing. But speaking of progress, remember, it's science was developed by a Christian culture and with many Christians at the vanguard. Sir Isaac Newton was a man of the Bible, thoroughly, totally believed it and taught it.
Bernie?
Well, yeah, it's kind of ridiculous that, yeah, Christians maybe did pioneer science, but how pathetic now that so many reject modern science, especially evolution. But then you brought up morality, which is a whole different subject. Let me bring up something new about the soul. I said there's no such thing as a soul. There's just the mind that emerges from the brain. This goes to the question, where do you think the soul comes from? Does it come at conception? Because there's a problem. Identical twins start off as one person, and then at some point it divides into two. So does that mean the original one had two souls if it was at conception? And then there's also the opposite, where there's a chimera, where there's two separate fetuses, and at some point they join into one fetus. So does that mean each one had a half a soul to begin with, if you get a soul there? And if a baby dies, is it a baby forever in heaven? Or if a senile person, is it forever senile in heaven? All of these things show the impossibility of how does it make sense to even believe in a soul. There is no such thing as a static kind of personality or person like the soul idea. The whole thing doesn't make sense when you look into it. But when
Time's up. Okay, you guys got 1 minute each, and then we're going to go into a two-minute summation. So, Rick, your turn.
Well, I think, you know, with all due respect to Bernie, and I know he's very sincere in his beliefs, I trust him with that, but when he says that Christians reject modern science, that is just like the most ridiculous thing I can hear that he has said so far, or at least close to it. No, that's not true. We accept it in millions of ways. Myself, not very scientific, I embrace science. I embrace the technology. This radio show would not be produced unless I affirmed so much of the science that's involved in it. As far as babies and what happens to them or senile people, yes, I can believe in impossible things. My existence is impossible. Your existence, the odds of us being able to live with all the scientific configurations that are necessary for that is just impossible. But we take so much on faith anyway. All of us do. You do too.
Okay, Bernie?
Okay, my thing about the babies is not saying it's impossible. I'm saying it's inconsistent. It doesn't make sense. Are you going to be a baby forever in heaven and all that? And as far as modern science, as far as I know, you reject human evolution. Human evolution is a fact that we evolved from other animals. That is a scientific fact nowadays, and you don't accept that. And you probably support a whole bunch of Christians that don't accept that. This is a whole movement, a Christian movement that is anti-science or maybe scientifically ignorant for not being able to accept the fact that humans evolved from other animals. And, of course, those Christians who do believe it, like Francis Collins, they're educated and they're smart, but it's amazing to me that you say you stand up for science, but yet you don't accept the fact of evolution.
Okay,
because
gentlemen.
Because that has happened is a fact.
Thank you. Gentlemen, it's time for your two-minute summation. So, and we are actually going to start with Bernie first, and then Rick will conclude.
Okay, I'll just summarize my points. My first point is a lot of Christians say that they know, you know, even forget about all the evidence, because the evidence, you can't prove it either way. Bottom line, I know it's all real because I feel Jesus in my heart. And I want to say, I know that feeling. I've been there. I've done that. And I now see it as a delusion. And the second thing is that extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. When somebody says, here's a really crazy claim, and it requires you to live your life in a certain way, then you really, really need to ask for what kind of evidence you have. And if it's just a bunch of miracle stories and gossip, why would you throw yourself, your life away for that? The third one is the resurrection is a historical claim, so you should look at it historically. And, for example, learn like the Gospels are written anonymously and how they're the synoptic Gospels are copied from each other, and Mark is the best and earliest, and it already has obvious examples of added stuff from the original. Number four, there's nothing to resurrect because there is no soul. Like I mentioned, how does the soul come in? I mean, the more you think about the soul, the more you understand how nonsense the whole idea is. There's just a mind that emerges from the brain. There's no supernatural soul. Another point is that historical miracles are impossible to figure out if they're true or not. I mean, there's magicians all the time that do things and claim things. And even now people say they talked to Jesus and they saw have a vision of Jesus. And, you know, they probably didn't. There's a lot of crazy stories about people that said they saw Jesus and all these weird things he did. 15
seconds, Bernie.
Okay, and the other thing is the prophecy. Nobody prophesied Jesus was going to die, the Messiah was going to die. That just happened. And then the most famous failed prophecy of all is the soon return of Christ. Total failure. 2,000 years and still counting. Okay.
Thank you, Bernie. Rick, it's time for your two-minute summation.
Bernie makes statements, but he doesn't really back them up with any facts. He says that evolution is a fact, according to the science, and that we aren't scientific if we don't believe that. According to the actual definition of a fact, evolution has never been proved as a fact, according to the very scientific method. Bernie has not proved that there's no soul. He just makes it as an assumption. So it's just a presumption, and that's it. A friend of mine named Steve Garrett, he gave some definitions that I thought were really germane here. He said, God, the creator, the I am, who requires nothing but desires to give everything to his most precious creation. Man, capable of so much in tandem with the creator, but sadly confused to believe he can do it all by himself. The accuser, the detractor, cunning with words and ruthless in power, usurped from the rightful heirs. The story, a tale told by an idiot, repeated eternally through time until the original message has been lost, buried beneath the rubbish heaped upon the name of I Am. The Redeemer, born from above to begin rebirth of creation, life overflowing, joy inexpressible, peace beyond understanding, proclaiming a message of hope. And finally, the mission. Return the creation to the Creator, the prodigal to the Father, the wayward to the path of life and hope. My friend Steve Garrett just happened to post that today, and I liked it so much I got his permission, and God bless
15
you.
15 seconds. 15 seconds.
That's
right?
It. I'm done. You
okay.
Can have the rest.
All right. All right, gentlemen, we are actually at the break, so Rick, do you want to take over and tell us how that's going to work? All right, and I'd like to remind callers that they can and hopefully will call in and ask their questions and make comments. Okay, now we're going to have Rick's printed statement, which I'll read. While I respect Bernie's sincere belief that Jesus did not rise from the dead, my critical thinking skills, along with science, faith, based not on feeling but on fact, history, and my personal experience of the Holy Spirit, all persuade me that Christ the Lord is risen today. Indeed, look at the multitude of fulfilled prophecies regarding Christ. See the mathematical impossibility of random chance for an intricate cell on a hand to exist, let alone all the other interconnected factors from the functions of fingers through atmospheric balance to gravitational pull of the sun upholding us. Note the overwhelming witnesses, the witness of the apostles, willing to die, not for a belief, but an event they witnessed, let alone historic verification. And, hopefully, behold your life lived by the same Spirit that raised up Christ Jesus from the dead, dwelling in you. All right, Rick, you have 5 minutes.
There's no way I can tackle all of those, but I'm going to start with the historical evidence. So, Bernie made a reference to William Lane Craig, who's a research professor of philosophy at Talbot School of Theology, which is one of your seminaries. And he says, virtually all scholars who deal with the resurrection, whatever their school of thought, assent to these three truths. We will see that the resurrection of Christ is the best explanation for each of them individually. Those three evidences is the empty tomb, the resurrection appearances, and the origin of the Christian faith. So, starting with the empty tomb, First, the resurrection was preached in the same city where Jesus had been buried shortly before Jesus' disciples did not go, or Jesus' disciples did not go to an obscure place where no one had heard of Jesus to begin preaching about the resurrection, but instead began preaching in Jerusalem. Read Acts chapter 2 and onward. Second, the earliest Jewish arguments against Christianity admit the empty tomb. In Matthew 28:11-15, there is a reference that is made to the Jews' attempt to refute Christianity from being true, saying that the disciples stole the body. The Toledoth Jesu, a compilation of early Jewish writings, is another source according to this. Third, the empty tomb account in the Gospel of Mark is based upon a source that originated within 7 years of the event it narrates. This places the evidence for the empty tomb too early to be legendary and makes it much more likely that it is accurate. Fourth, the empty tomb is supported by the historical reliability of the burial story. New Testament scholars agree that the burial story is one of the best established facts about Jesus. One reason for this is because of the inclusion of Joseph of Arimathea as the one who buried Christ. Joseph was a member of the Jewish Sanhedrin, a sort of Jewish Supreme Court. People in this ruling class were simply too well known for fictitious stories about them to be pulled off in this way. Then there's the resurrection appearances. Okay, there's the evidence that Jesus' disciples had real experiences with one whom they believed was the risen Christ. This is not commonly disputed today because we have the testimony of the original disciples themselves that they saw Jesus alive again. And you don't have to believe in the reliability of the Gospels to believe this. In 1 Corinthians 15:3-8, Paul records an ancient creed concerning Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection appearances that is much earlier than the letter in which Paul is recording it, which was around 57 AD. It is generally agreed by critical scholars that Paul received this creed from Peter and James between 3 to 5 years after the crucifixion. 10 people would not all give their lives for something they know to be a lie. The hallucination theory is untenable because it cannot explain the physical nature of the appearances. I read from 1 John chapter 1 a little bit earlier about John. The disciples record eating and drinking with Jesus as well as touching him. This cannot be done with hallucinations. Second, it is highly unlikely that they would have all had the same hallucination. Hallucinations are highly individual and not group projections. Since the disciples could not have been lying or hallucinating, we have only one possible explanation left. The disciples believed that they had seen the risen Jesus because they really had seen the risen Jesus. Do I have time for the origin of Christian faith, or am I out of time?
You've got a minute.
Okay. Could it have been Christian influences, the origin of Christian faith? Since the belief in the resurrection was itself the foundation for Christianity, it cannot be explained as the later product of Christianity. But what about pagan influences? First, it has been shown that these mystery religious had no major influence in Palestine in the first century. Second, most of the sources which contain parallels originated after Christianity was established. Third, most of the similarities are often apparent and not real, a result of sloppy terminology on the part of those who explain them. Well, I have more to say, but I guess,
time's up.
You know, did you, yeah, go ahead.
Okay, Bernie, 5 minutes.
Okay, I'm trying to read in the. Sorry, I'm in my car and it's kind of dark. Okay. Oh, so as far as there's all these stories about the empty tomb appearances and all this stuff, and all these experts that William Lane Craig refers to, again, a lot of these experts who would validate that the resurrection, that's like asking a bunch of Book of Mormon experts about the Book of Mormon. Of course, they're going to do that. I mean, you got to talk to people who are really academic Bible scholars and not just conservative ones, and the conservative ones aren't going to say that that's the best explanation. He talked about the Book of Matthew, which, you know, is a copy based on Mark, and Mark is about 30 years after the event. That's one thing I mentioned earlier. Mentioning Corinthians, which is supposed to be referring to an earlier creed, that's a sign that the the creed was institutionalized, which means there, you know, the people got together and they came up with their doctrines. Again, this is all kind of just nothing was really written down, and it was all kind of verbal, and finally somebody wrote something down. And he said people wouldn't give their lives for this. Well, again, there's no good evidence. This is where the viewer has to do their own research and look at what the evidence is for this claim that people gave their lives for the story, because from the expert diaper, there is no evidence for that. It's just a claim that's made over and over in church. He says you can't do hallucinations like touching people or whatever. Robert Price gave a story of a woman he met who said she saw Jesus, and Jesus asked her what she wanted, and she asked to live to like 100 years old, like a lot of people in her family. And she said, I want more. I want you to write this down with a pencil. And he did, supposedly. Of course, he said he didn't see it. He didn't look for it. He wasn't there. But there are people who claim these kind of things. Now, in Acts, it talks about Jesus ascending up in the heavens physically. So I'm saying right there, that's evidence the story is made up, because nowadays, no Christian is going to say heaven is literally above the clouds. That's what they believed then. But nowadays, they would say, oh, heaven's in a different dimension. But back then, they thought it was literally up there in the sky, and we don't think that anymore. As far as all these Christians, you know, the resurrection was the core. Who knows what the core was? There's so many different Christians that burned out the other Christians as heretics. I mean, I came from a Catholic family originally. I grew up as a Catholic family. And a lot of the Catholics say, if you look at the oldest beliefs, they all believe in the literal presence in the Eucharist. In other words, when the priest does his incantation, that wafer is literally Jesus, even though it doesn't look like it and taste like it. But you're eating that wafer. You're literally eating Jesus. And they go to the oldest manuscripts, oldest documents, everything. So are you going to now become a Catholic and believe in the Eucharist because that's what the earliest Christians believed? You know, you got to ask yourself if you're going to be consistent, you know. And of course you're going to say, well, of course I can't believe that wafer is literally Jesus. That's nonsense. But they actually used ancient science called accidents and substance to try to explain it. And of course it's nonsense now. I think it's called Aristotelian physics or something like that. They were saying that the appearance could be different on the outside than the substance. And of course we know that's nonsense now. So, yeah, there's a lot of all kinds of weird beliefs, but it's hard to say what people believed back then because they killed each other over their communities to try to get the same beliefs in the community. So I'll leave it with that.
Okay, Rick, 3 minutes.
Okay. Okay, so I concluded from what Bernie said that conservatives are not academic. I guess when I look at history, I see something different. When I look at brilliant minds today, I see something different. Even the guy that debated Bernie a few months ago is a brilliant man and held his own very well with Bernie, much better debater than myself, I would say. And the man who is conducting the Truth Project, another very cogent and academic man, much more than myself, there's plenty of that around. I've met many of those guys, and there's many more that are probably more brilliant than I haven't. Matthew is not a copy of Mark. There's even apparent contradictions between them, which are cited as proof that the Bible's not accurate. Actually, it's more proof that there's not collusion, which actually verifies that the veracity of independent scholarship on their parts. They just saw things differently. One went by a Roman clock, one went by a Jewish clock, therefore you have different times, and other things that are apparent paradoxes or contradictions. The ascension going up into heaven, yeah, it's Bernie's right. Heaven isn't necessarily above, but there's three heavens that are mentioned in the scriptures, and so the picture of heaven that Jesus was presenting was the ascension into the first heaven, which is our atmosphere. The second heaven is outer space. The third heaven is in a different dimension. We have a concept of that. We were able to conceive of different dimensions, even scientifically, not just science fiction. And so Jesus ended up into another dimension, obviously, which is beyond all of where any of us have been up to now. Counterfeits, he brought up the Mormons, he brought up the Catholics with transubstantiation, which is the doctrine of the Eucharist becoming the real-life Jesus. that's where science and logic comes in. And also poetry. I'm into poetry. That is a field I'm comfortable with. And I recognize John 6 as a metaphor. The Catholics, I believe, you know, I respect them. I believe they're true in faith in many ways. Many true believers are, but they missed it on that. They missed the metaphor. And because it contradicts the body of Scripture, if Jesus was, how could Jesus say, this is my body about it? And then yet there he was, which was his body, the one that was speaking or the little wafer that he was holding or the piece of bread or whatever. And as far as the kill one another, which was mentioned two or three times by Bernie, there's been plenty of secularists that did that too. And Christians, by and large, were not crusaders or inquisitioners. They were compassionate, loving saints or Francis of Assisi type people, Martin Luther people that brought love or truth into this world. And so that's what I have to say.
Bernie? That was my alarm clock. Bernie, you're up for 3 minutes.
Okay, yeah, I think Rick brought up the Truth Project. I think that's a project, one thing is they're anti-evolution, and this is something that some of the Christians are saying that, you know, it's really a shame because it's making a mockery of Christianity for these Christians who don't believe in evolution. Just wanted to say that the first Christians, you know, if you do your research and it finds out, turns out that the first Christians did believe in the real presence of Christ, like Catholics believe today, it's interesting how you say, well, of course, that's nonsense, but then, you know, you still say, oh, well, we got to still listen to some of the other nonsense, like, you know, the resurrection. You know, I think you can dismiss them both on the same grounds of logical thinking. Now, my point about Christians killing each other wasn't that they're evil because they're killing each other. I was just saying that's how the belief systems worked out, is where they killed the opposing ideas. I mean, when you had a religious community and somebody else had another idea, they don't say, oh, okay, that's interesting. They say, no, you're a heretic. We'll kill you if you don't leave here. We don't want you corrupting our minds. So it's really difficult to find out what the ancients believed because they were so quick to kill each other in different communities. And I just wanted to, the bottom line, the reason why I had to leave finally Christianity, the first break was evolution, which is a big deal, because that shows that there is no such thing as a first man. That means there's no sin, there's no Adam and Eve and all that. But the next thing was, like I said, there's no soul, there's nothing to resurrect. And when you think about the soul, it just becomes nonsense, because like I said, identical twins, you know, if the soul's giving at conception, it doesn't make sense with identical twins and chimeras. And then, you know, people who die in infancy or in senile old age. I mean, just think about those questions. And I know the Christian just puts their brain on hold and says, okay, you know what, someday I'll find out in heaven. That's what they do. But when you think about it, and if you think about it from a naturalistic worldview, it's like, wow, if there is no soul, supernatural soul, and if the mind just emerges from the brain, now all of a sudden it makes sense. What we see is what we get. There's none of these inherent contradictions. So when you have a naturalistic worldview, the world comes into clearer view and makes sense. But when you have these religious beliefs, you just got to say, oh, well, I don't know. Nobody knows. Someday we'll find out in heaven. It's just admit it. It doesn't work out. And, you know, it's being intellectually honest. Even though it's painful to give up cherished beliefs, you just got to have a devotion to the truth above all else. You know, even if it disrupts your family or whatever. I mean, you have to have a devotion to the truth, because if you don't, it's going to lead to pain later on, more pain, I believe. So I'll leave it there.
Yeah, you're just out of time, Bernie, so that's good. Okay, I'd like to remind anyone listening that they are invited to call in and join the discussion. The telephone number is area code 760-283-5126. That is area code 760-283-5126. Rick, do we have any callers?
Not at the moment. I would let you know.
Okay. So then the format is to go into the one-minute rapid-fire rebuttal. So, Rick, you're up for a minute.
Evolution is not science truth, but it's a recent theory with many problems. Nonsense. I will give the evolutionists the benefit of the doubt, and the Piltdown Man hoax and many other hoaxes, I won't use that against them to disprove their theory, but it does show that they have their pig's tooth's tooth, like the farcical Darrow trials back in the 1920s. It's not arbitrary to believe and have faith. Jesus himself said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." And the moral code and the all of what Christianity has brought to the world by following Jesus, this is not arbitrary things. And the Bible is a guide, a psychological guide. That's how I use it as a counselor to how to live. So this is not arbitrary nonsense. There's a lot of substantial history, art, poetry, science even some, and definitely psychology in the Word of God, I would say that. Okay. I'll leave it there.
Okay. Bernie, 1 minute. Are you there, Bernie? 1 minute.
Sorry about that. I had mute on. I wonder if I could just list some questions, and Rick can use my time to answer these. But like I said, think about it. How do you explain these things if there's a soul? Like, there's probably like an 80% natural miscarriage rate that women have miscarriages and don't even know it. That's a lot of aborted fetuses. And people, when they're senile, when they die, what are they like in heaven, you know? How do you answer these questions with a soul? Because I'm convinced there is no soul, and that's why there's no such thing as a resurrection.
Well, science doesn't answer that question either, but taking it from a biblical mindset, or God loves his race. He loves the human race, and those babies are innocents, and they didn't get a chance, whether they were aborted or miscarried. They did not get a chance to make it here on earth, those that were not able to. But someone who's a senile person, or someone who's a little infant, or even, you know, inside a fetus baby, a human being, which science verifies that, has verified the position that Christians have taken since Roe versus Wade. The idea there is that God is a restorer. He is one who restores people. And so a person who's a little infant, it doesn't mean that there won't be any changes in heaven. That young child, the innocence, will be able to bloom and blossom in heaven and become a full person, retaining that innocence. They won't have all the regrets that have to be washed out of their eyes, so to speak. That's a picture that's given in Revelation. And the senile person will also be able to have a chance to be restored. We see restoration. We see miracles happening here on earth, and even natural healings that people experience. So it's not that far of a stretch to see that in heaven. And
time's
that
up,
is
Rick.
The picture we have.
Okay, Bernie, another question or a comment?
Yeah, just to follow up on that. For example, when a fetus, there's no such thing as blooming in heaven or blossoming in heaven. A person becomes who they are based on where they grow up. In other words, if you were born in a poor country or a poor family or a rich family in a different culture, you would become a different person because of the way you emerged. And, you know, if you're a fetus, you're not going to grow up in heaven learning Spanish or English or some other language. The whole thing is nonsense. So basically, you are what you are because of the path you went through life. So it's totally nonsense to think somehow you could raise some kind of way in heaven. I mean, it makes no sense whatsoever. It's a critical concept called emergence, which basically talks about how things emerge. And emergence explains how people are and how we come to be. And when you see things from a naturalistic viewpoint like that, everything makes perfect sense. But, I mean, to say that you would bloom and blossom in heaven, I mean, it just makes no sense. You'd have no environment. You'd have nothing specific to shape
Time's
you.
Up. Time's up. Thank you, Bernie. Rick, 1 minute.
I find it incredible that that someone who doesn't believe in heaven, Bernie, knows more about heaven than me when he says a statement, "No such thing of blooming and blossoming in heaven." That makes no sense. I would like to refer him and also my listeners here to Randy Alcorn's excellent book called Heaven. And Randy was intelligent enough and also humble enough to say that he could be wrong on a number of these things. He's utilizing scripture, but it's really hard to nail it down. But the picture you have is a dynamic wonderfulness and growth in heaven, whereas hell will be a place of stagnation and a place of loneliness. And the soul there will shrink, whereas in heaven it will expand unbelievably. And so it's not a far-fetched to see that a person who's, let's say, 35 years old and intelligent and physically strong, but has done a lot of sin, but has been redeemed by the Lamb, will find more purity and more excellence there in heaven and redeem much of what was lost here on earth. And a person who's lost many of their faculties, maybe they experience senility or something of that nature, Alzheimer's, will be also have that ability to be restored because of what God can do. And the same for the fetus.
Bernie?
Okay, I'll next talk about this idea of the soul. I actually got all these ideas from my Christian conference. When you consider the case of identical twins, what happens is you have a fertilized egg. So for the first time when the sperm hits the egg, you have a full chromosome set, so you have a full person here. And then that you know, cell multiplies and multiplies and multiplies. And at some point, it divides into two. So that whole mass divides into two people. And that's why they're identical twins, is because their DNA is identical. Now, if you get a soul at conception, this is a big problem, because it's like, wow, there was one for the longest time, and now there's two. How the heck did God just say, oh, okay, here, you need another soul? Or did he know this in advance? Of course, God's supposed to know all in advance. So did he give him two souls? Well, it doesn't make sense for one person to have two souls. So none of this makes sense. And so then you say, okay, well, maybe God put a soul in sometime later. Okay, so now you have to figure out, is it at one day? Is it at 5 days? Is it at 3 weeks? Is it 3 months? And it's like, oh, no, okay, it's at 45 days. I mean, you're just coming up with, you know, it's random. So these are kind of the ideas that I'm talking about. When you think about the soul, the more you think about it, the more nonsense it is.
Okay, Bernie, thank you. Rick, 1 minute.
Okay, I think Bernie's really departed from the topic here, so I'm going to kind of skip over what he had to say and say that Genesis 3 tells us that by Moses, and there's several authors in the Old Testament, Moses being one of them, one of the greatest, he said that there was a seed that will, when man fell, that there was a seed that would redeem humankind, and that seed would bruise the heel of the enemy. Then we see in Colossians that at the cross, in Colossians 2, that the one at the cross, who is obviously Jesus, disarmed principalities and powers and made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them. We see fulfilled prophecy there. There are hundreds and hundreds of prophecies of what Jesus would be doing, and I'll get to some of the resurrection ones here. If I only have a minute, I can't get to all of them now, but there's a number of those also. So we see overwhelming evidence of independent writers through 2,000 years, from Job all the way down to the apostles, where we see fulfillment of prophecy. And also, Bernie's incorrect about the prophecy of the second coming.
Okay. I would like to remind anyone listening that they are encouraged to call in and with their questions or comments. And the number that you would call is area code 760-283-5126. And that is area code 760-283-5126. Call in and join the debate. Gentlemen, we've got about 30 minutes to go, including your two-minute summation. So we'll continue with the one-minute rebuttals if that's agreeable to you.
I would like to suggest, Robert, that we go to 2 minutes because the prophetic word, I'd like to address that now. I've already addressed some of the historical without all my points of that, but a little bit of the prophetical, and then that would give Bernie enough time to refute some of those. So if Bernie is amenable to that.
Well, you last spoke, so I'd like to follow up on what you just said last.
Oh, of course.
Yes, yeah, that's good, Bernie. And then, Bernie, are you agreeable, since we don't have a caller, that we might
sure.
take 2 minutes?
Sure. A caller
each?
Just came in, so let's go to the caller here. All right.
Well, can I can I make a quick just response first, just 30 seconds or so?
Go ahead, Bernie.
Okay, so the reason why I brought up this thing about the identical twins and everything is because my point is that it doesn't make sense to think about a soul. And if there's no soul, then the whole thing about resurrection doesn't make sense. I just think we have the mind that emerged from the brain, that's it. And then the second thing about prophecy is kind of like, that's pretty interesting to think that this was prophesied that Christ would die on the cross, because nobody saw that coming. They never thought their Messiah was going to come and die on the cross. That was a total shocker.
Can I have 30 seconds to address the twin thing? Just a real quick comment?
Yes. Go ahead, Rick.
Okay. We're indulging, I know. Identical twins are not identical. I have two grandkids that are identical twins. They are not identical people. They are very different with different personalities, and they have different souls. So that's all I can say on that.
Okay.
You know,
let's go to the caller. Okay. Let's go to the caller.
All right. So we have the caller on. So you are on. Could you give your first name and the state that you're calling from?
Sure. This is Jersey. I'm calling from Oregon.
Your name is Jersey?
Correct.
But you're not from Jersey, huh? Okay, sorry about that. Anyway, Oregon from Jersey, or Jersey from Oregon, go ahead and address us with a question, either one of us or to both of us.
Sure. So I heard a Christian caller call, so I thought maybe I would join in since I'm an atheist. And we're specifically talking, you guys are talking specifically about resurrection. So I wanted to ask a couple of questions about the points that were brought up as proof for resurrection. So the first one was the empty tomb. And to be honest, the empty tomb claim is still something that is only a claim, because there isn't really a historical confirmation that there was a body of Jesus there. To my understanding, there's only writings in the book that say that the tomb was empty, and there isn't anything else that is confirmed by independent scholars or by independent accounts that this is clearly a historical fact. So that's the first thing. The second one was brought up, which is resurrection experiences. And, you know, I don't know what it is, if it's hallucinations, if it's hysteria, or if it's really the truth. It's hard to tell. However, it's still only an account written in a single book. And something like this would have been likely confirmed by independent accounts, independent writers that have no interest, that are not disciples, that are not part of the same Jesus ministry. But something that is truly extraordinary would have been noticed by ancient or modern people at that time. So still looking at it, I have to say that, you know, I need to remain in this belief that this is something that is really true, as a proof.
Thank you, Julie. Stay on the line if you want, if you've got more questions.
One more thing, but go ahead.
Okay. Rick, would you like to rebut or start first?
Yeah, I'm flipping through my papers here, which makes it difficult. But while I'm doing that, I'm looking something up here, and I think I just found it. Yeah, I did. But I don't think it's fair to say there aren't independent accounts just because they're believers. I think if something occurred and you are convinced that it occurred, just like evolutionists, they believe in what they believe. And so, you know, just because there's more than one, just three or four, just because they all believe in something in the same way doesn't mean that that makes them wrong. I don't think evolutionists are wrong because there's so many of them. Just because there were four separate accounts, there wasn't one account. There were four different authors that wrote, and there were 500 witnesses recorded that recognized that Jesus was alive after he was dead. I don't have time now, but Lee Strobel gives an excellent account, quoting from a medical doctor, certainty of what took place at the cross would not just be a swoon, but an actual death of Jesus. Now, another independent account, since this man is asking for that, and that is Josephus, in 20.9, wait a minute, I missed that. Josephus, who was Jewish and had no vested interest in Christianity himself. In Jewish Antiquities, Book 18, Chapter 3, Paragraph 3, said, "Now there was about this time Jesus, a wise man, if it be lawful to call him a man, for he was a doer of wonderful works, a teacher of such men as received the truth with pleasure. He drew over to him both many of the Jews and many of the Gentiles. He was claimed to be the Christ, and when Pilate, at the suggestion of the principal men among us, had condemned him to the cross, those that loved him at the first did not forsake him, for he appeared to them alive again the third day, as the divine prophets had foretold these and 10,000 other wonderful things concerning him." This was written by a man.
Okay.
Time's up, Rick. Okay, I gave Rick 2 minutes. Bernie, take 2 minutes.
Can I respond to that?
And then Jersey will have you on right after Rick, or right after Bernie.
Okay, yeah. I'm surprised Rick mentioned that from Josephus. I think even the conservative seminaries will tell you that part is a known forgery addition, that part that he quoted. There's two parts. I think one part is really brief, and the second part is the embellishment. And I think that's the well-known part that he quoted that is an embellishment. Even a conservative scholar would say that was that's a scam, basically. Rick again mentioned evolution. I was, that's based on evidence, not on testimonies or anything. He says there's these four authors. Well, again, nobody knows who wrote these things. And he says 500 people appeared. Jesus appeared to 500. Who are they? Paul just mentioned them. He didn't give any way to check it at all. And Lee Strobel talks about a medical doctor who would have said what happened at the execution. That's all hearsay. I mean, imagine this took place. Here's how it would have happened. That's all he's saying. It doesn't add anything at all to the facts at hand or anything about the history. Okay.
Thank you, Bernie. Yep. Jersey, did you have another question?
I just had a response to what I think Rick was saying in terms of the independent account. Notwithstanding what Bernie said, I want to just say that what Josephus was saying is basically that there were people who were claiming these things, and then maybe there was a man who existed and who did wonderful things. That still doesn't prove that he was resurrected, and then doesn't prove that he exists somewhere. And then that's really my other question is, I can't understand this claim. This is a very modern claim, because ancients did not have that concept of multiple dimensions. This modern claim of Jesus existing now and existing in a different dimension. I mean, basic question is, what proof do you have that there is another dimension? And what makes you say that he exists in there? And what is the base for this belief, you know, in terms of the facts?
Okay, Rick?
Okay. So Bernie called Josephus a forgery, or he said a lot of people are saying that. Where's the proof? What conservative people? Start naming a list of them. The medical doctor is hearsay. If he was an evolutionist and he said that the resurrection never happened or the death never happened, would that then make him more palatable to the Jesus Seminar group, that's a radical anti-Christian intellectual group? Were Paul of Tarsus, Corey Ten Boom, Justice Martyr, John Piper, Johann Gutenberg, Ignatius of Antioch, William Wilberforce, Alexander Solzhenitsyn, C.S. Lewis, Anne Hutchinson, Augustine of Hippo, Fyodor Dostoevsky, John the Cross, Elizabeth Elliot, Dwight Moody, John Wycliffe, and Francis Assisi all wrong, but Jersey and Bernie are right?
That's time. Bernie.
I think one thing Rick might find interesting is if you read C.S. Lewis, Mere Christianity, the last chapter is called The New Men, and he talks about evolution as an analogy for the gospel. So C.S. Lewis obviously didn't have a problem with evolution, and not only that, but he used evolution as a really neat analogy. So I think you'll find that's pretty funny, I think.
Well, my comment to that is that C.S. Lewis might be a good bridge to the gospel for you, that it's true. C.S. Lewis did not have all the conventional views of a conservative Christian, but he did believe in the resurrection, so I don't know what to do with that.
Jersey, if you're still with us, I'll let you have one more question.
I can comment on that. That was a long list of names, and I appreciate you doing the research. But I do want to point out that these great minds are people who are people of their times. And at certain times it was, I would say, dangerous to your life not to believe or even profess to not believe in God. Many of the scholars separated their work on science from their beliefs, and the great work they did had nothing to do with metaphysical, but everything to do with physical work. And, you know, Newton didn't pray for calculus. Copernicus was afraid to publish his work because of the threats objections from the religious people that he would get, and potentially death threats. So I think people who do great work are great minds, but that doesn't mean that they wouldn't separate their beliefs from what actually they do in terms of the reality. So I'm not impressed by the list. I understand there are plenty of very smart people who are believers, and I am very respectful of that. However, the beliefs are traditional, and they come from where people are born, because great science work was done by the Muslim world until the mullahs put basically a stopper to that in the 6th century. And that's not only the Christian invention science, but also a number of other societies and civilizations had great science.
Thank you, Jersey, for joining us. I'd like to remind other callers or other listeners that they can call in and are encouraged to do so at area code 760-283-5126. That is area code 760-283-5126. Call in and join the debate. Rick, 1 minute.
All right. I guess to Jersey, Corey Timboom, Solzhen Zensky, and Elizabeth Elliot, who are modern figures of the 20th century, all paid a dear price for their faith in the resurrection of Christ. They were persecuted, and Elizabeth Elliot's husband lost his life. Elizabeth Elliot made great sacrifices. Corey Timboom lost her sister's life in a Nazi concentration camp. Solzhen Zensky, we know his story, and another one. So there's many great believers that, no, they did not have the popular point of view, and they had to suffer for it. Another prophecy, because I think that kind of gets back to our main point, is that there's been prophecies, but I don't want to use up more than my minute, so I'll catch it on another minute if I get an opportunity. Or maybe we can expand it.
Yeah, Jersey kind of started the question with what evidence is there of another dimension, and how do you know Jesus is in there? I would imagine that Rick might have answered, I just feel it. I know Jesus is alive because I feel the relationship with them. So I just want to reiterate how feelings cannot determine the truth of Jesus' existence at all, not in any way, shape, or form. Rick mentioned about those persecuted for their faith. You know, so what? There's Mormons and Muslims who also give their life for their faith. And, of course, you think the Mormon theology is all messed up nonsense and, you know, like, and also the Muslim theology is messed up nonsense. I mean, the Muslims reject Jesus as God. So, and you know, that he rose from the dead and all that. So, you know, being persecuted for your faith means nothing compared, you know, in regards to knowing the truth. It means nothing whatsoever. It just means somebody has strong conviction. So what?
Okay, gentlemen, we've got 13 minutes before your two-minute summation. I'll mention one more time, if there's anyone listening that would like to join the debate, that they can call in at area code 760-283-5126. That is area code 760-283-5126. Unless it's unanimous between the two of you, we're going to stick with the one-minute rebuttal. So, Rick, go ahead. You're next.
All right. I could do a quick one on the failed prophecy, because that is a good, strong argument of atheists. And I'd say that for dispensational Christians, they pretty much triumph in that argument. But there are many Christians, and I'm not saying what position I take, but many Christians of a Reformed theology, for instance, that take a different position. There's many different positions, and some say that either in some sense or in many senses, whatever, Jesus did return in AD 70. He predicted he would. He said that he would. And also he talked about the destruction of the temple at that time. And yes, there are many prophecies. I agree with Bernie on that. I think he makes a good point, and it's a strong argument. But the answer is that it was fulfilled either partially or fully or however we want to say it. I want to get into theology here. But there was a type of that return that occurred. And yes, Matthew chapter 16, verse 27, 28, I don't have it in front of me, but it states it rather clearly. Actually, if I have time, I'll get that out because maybe that's something that Bernie would want me to.
Let's let Bernie rebut, and then you can bring it up next. Okay, Bernie?
Yeah, I mean, you admit that theologians have to argue. They have to argue about the return of Christ. Some say they're called preterists, that Jesus already returned. Why? Well, because the temple was destroyed, and it has to do with the temple and all that stuff, and the temple being rebuilt and all these things. But anyway, basically they argue about whether Jesus really returned or not. I mean, why is there problems in theology? It's because the Bible is all murky, and it's exactly what you would expect if you had different people writing different things, and now you're trying to say that it's one monolithic story. Matthew, Mark, and Luke are not one monolithic story. There are when you look at the gospel and try to reconcile, especially the resurrection, what happened, they have inconsistencies that cannot be worked out. In other words, like when Jesus resurrected, did he tell them to go to Galilee, or did he say stay in Jerusalem? Because it's two different stories. There are contradictions.
Okay, Rick.
And so that's just one obvious contradiction.
Rick, 1 minute.
The Bible murky, I 100% agree with Bernie. Jesus himself said that to the unbeliever, the Bible is murky and that it can only be spiritually discerned. So to an unbeliever, yes, it is foolishness to the unbeliever. I agree with him. Psalm 2, verses 1 to 2, 7 to 8. Why do the heathen rage and the people devise a vain thing? This is David, not Moses, another prophet. The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, I will declare the decree. The Lord hath said to me, thou art my son. This day I have begotten thee. Okay, prophecy. Fulfillment, Acts chapter 13. And though they found no cause for death in him, yet they asked Pilate that he should be slain, and so forth. And it says, but God raised him from the dead, and he was seen many days. This was the fulfillment of that prophecy in Acts chapter 2, that there would be a resurrection.
Bernie, 1 minute.
Okay, so, I mean, that's really funny that Rick would say these things have to be spiritually discerned. And so, okay, so who's the one spiritually discerning it correct? Is it the Baptist, or is it the Catholics, or is it the Mormons? You know, that's kind of a joke. They have to be spiritually discerned. This is what all the Christian groups, these born-again Christians, they start their own church at the drop of a hat without even being formally educated. And, you know, how can you do that? Oh, because the Spirit of God is upon me, and the Spirit teaches me. We have no need for man's wisdom and all that kind of stuff. So, I mean, that's pretty amazing to say these things are spiritually discerned, therefore don't even talk to a non-believer. And, by the way, you can say that I never believed, but some other Christians deal with me by saying, oh, you know what, I'm a backslider. So, you know, you can have it either way. Some people who know me, they would never say that I was never a Christian because they know how I gave my life for Jesus, how I did everything. I mean, even was going to start a church. I've done so much for Jesus, but now I see it as a delusion. So I'll just leave it there, I guess, for now.
Time's up. Rick?
Disagreements, yes. Christians don't always behave themselves. There's a rule of thumb, unity in the essentials. There's an amazing amount of unity among Christians. It's called koinonia. I feel that fellowship. I won't mention his denomination, but I'll say that my friend Robert comes from a totally different background or tradition than I do. But in the spirit, we come together in unity, don't we, brother?
Yes. Yes, we do.
Okay, we do. but diversity and liberty in the non-essentials. He and I, we can debate ourselves and pick up points, but on the essentials of the faith, there's that unity, and then there's charity in everything, and that's where some Christians miss it, and shame on them. Shame on them. We should be able to disagree in a friendly way. We believe in diversity in the church very much, but there's a unity on the essentials, which is, by the way, love, which he said it doesn't have much to do with truth, but love and truth are actually the essentials of the Bible.
Next time.
Oh, and I left out part of that. Oh, go ahead.
Bernie, go ahead.
Yeah, you know, it's kind of interesting. That's you have an interesting theology there about love and unity, or however you specify that. I know that saying. It's been a while, but that's an interesting theology. That's a little different theology than other people. You know, some of the Catholics and Protestants have different theology about truth above all, and they kill each other. You know, they're heretics. So, you know, I guess since you can spiritually discern things, I think you must think that you have a higher theology closer to God than they did. So, I mean, yeah, everybody's got their own spiritual discernment. So.
That's good.
Thank you, Bernie. Rick, 1 minute.
Robert, I'm looking at our time because we do need a little bit of closing time. So I think we need to go to our summations. I'll let him have the last word there. And, you know, there's plenty of other prophecies, but they'll be for another day, I guess, or maybe. But
all right.
I think
2 minutes each.
Yeah.
Bernie, do you want to make your summation statement then for 2 minutes?
Yeah, I could do that.
All right. Go right ahead.
Okay, I'm just going to reiterate my 6 points because I think they're really interesting points and it's good for people to hear them again. The first one is that I want you to – a lot of Christians say no matter what, I know that, you know, the resurrection is true because I just have a relationship with Jesus in my heart. And I want to reiterate, I know that feeling and I believe it's a delusion. And it's actually a logical fallacy that you can discern truth through feelings. It's called the appeal to emotion. So just as, you know, a Mormon can't decide the truth of the Book of Mormon through feelings, you know, you can't do the same thing about the resurrection. The second thing is that extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. When somebody says, here's a really wild claim, and plus you have to reorientate your whole life because of it, you should really ask for extra evidence to support that. The third one is the thing about the resurrection. It's a historical claim, so you should treat it as any other historical thing. Don't give it special credence just because you grew up in a Christian country or a Christian family. You know, you need to know things like the Gospels are anonymously written. You know, people in church don't know that. They think it was really the Gospels were really written by Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, but nobody knows. That's the truth. There's nothing. The next point is, number four, there's nothing to resurrect. We have the mind that emerges from the brain. There is no such thing as a soul. And I gave a bunch of illustrations to talk about that, you know, like chimeras and identical twins and infants that die and senile people that die, et cetera. If you have a naturalistic worldview, it all makes sense. Number five, it's hard to historically evaluate a miracle because it could be a magician or whatever, and there's nothing to be reproduced. And even people today say they see Jesus and things like that. And number six, the prophecies. Nobody prophesied Jesus was going to die on the cross, that he was going to be a Messiah, that kind of Messiah. And then the most famous failed prophecy of all is the soon return of Christ. It's all over the it's all over the Gospels, all over the Bible, and it's been 2,000 years and going. Jesus is not going to return because he's no longer here. If he ever was a person, he's no longer here now. The person that is in the Gospels is, it could be based on a real person, but it's mostly all myth. And every religion has their own myth. You know, the Greeks had their own myth, Greek mythology, Hindu mythology, Norse mythology. This is just Christian mythology. And I
think
just calling it Christian mythology instead of Christian theology. Okay, thanks.
Thank you, Bernie. Rick, your summation? 2 minutes?
In the words of Alexander Solzhenitsyn, I can't say his name, over a half century ago, while I was still a child, I recall hearing a number of old people offer the following explanation for the great disasters that has befallen Russia. Men have forgotten God. That's why all this has happened. Since then, I have spent well nigh 50 years working on the history of our revolution. In the process, I have read hundreds of books, collected hundreds of personal testimonies, and have already contributed 8 volumes of my own toward the effort of clearing away the rubble left by that upheaval. But if I were asked today to formulate as concisely as possible the main cause of the ruinous revolution that swallowed up some 60 million of our people, I could not put it more accurately than to repeat, men have forgotten God. That's why all this has happened. I think a man that has suffered and has the intellectual esteem that a man like Alexander Solzhenitsyn has, I think states it very well, and it's a fitting conclusion to what I have to say.
Thank you, gentlemen, for the very interesting